and welcome to this meeting of the Russell Cotes Art Gallery and Museum Management Committee meeting. I am obliged to just make this note for those who may be joining us online. Please note that this meeting of the Russell Cotes Art Gallery and Museum and Management Committee is being live streamed and will be recorded by the Council to support the production of the minutes for the use of democratic services. For ourselves, in order to ensure the meeting is managed effectively, please could everyone present follow the ground rules for speaking, only speaking when invited by myself, and to mute your microphones when you are not speaking. Well, those matters, delivered, I invite you to turn to the agenda for our meeting and to note the following apologies. Claire, I am remiss at not introducing you. Thank you. We know that Nikki is unwell today, so I know you're deputising for her. Do you have apologies?
Thank you, Chair. Yes, we have received one apology from this meeting, and that's from Councillor Lawrence Williams, the Vice Chair.
And I think we can add the apology of Greg Irvin, who is unable to join us today. Declarations of interest. So it is a customary requirement that anybody here declare any interests which may impact upon agenda items we're to consider. I'm looking at yourself, Mohan and Beverly, and I believe there are no declarations of interest. That allows us to turn to the third item, which is the consideration of the confirmation of the minutes of the meeting, which was held on the 30th of January last. are there any textual amendments that members of the committee will wish to add? And may I therefore take as approved those minutes? Agreed. Thank you very much. Matters arising for the minutes. This isn't an agenda item. I was rather curious why it isn't. But, I invite anybody to raise any matters arising. Alan.
The very last item, a bulletin be produced, which would help to keep people up to date with progress. Which people did we have in mind for this?
I think that once again may fall to you, Sarah.
I think my recollection is it was visitors, wasn't it?
I think it was visitors and stakeholders was the idea of upkeeping a sort of log and updating people on progress within externalisation. That was my recollection.
Any other matters arising? Well, I do have one, and it relates to item 40, the financial statements, which were considered. And in particular, the note from the external auditor who was in attendance, Nick Hiscos, who said that the auditors had encountered quite significant difficulty because the charity does not have a separate bank account, but uses the council's own financial arrangements. I raise this here because as we move into a very critical period of transition, the necessity of having a financial point of reference is going to be increasingly important. And I'm just curious as to the means through which we could transact this and seek advice really from members who may have more experience in this matter with BCP.
Thank you. I did take this one off as I hear myself, which isn't great. I did follow this up, actually. I spoke to finance about why we couldn't do this. And oh God, I'm a bit thick-headed this morning. And they did actually come back rather than what I was trying to ascertain, that it wasn't like on the too difficult pile, that there were some actual reasons why we couldn't do it. And she did come back with two or three points. And Chris Saunders popped in and said, ah, I see now why we can't do it. And I was just trying to drop on the email, but I can't quite find it. But there is actually a good reason why we can't, the council can't do that separation. I'm not sure how useful this is because I can't quite recall it all. But there was a very valid reason. And Chris Saunders said, ah, I understand now why. Because what we're concerned about, that it was just, as I say, a bit too difficult. But that situation will change, won't it, as we go forward and we become a completely, we become an independent charity, then that is the time to do it. But I think that whilst we are still in this process and part of the council, I think that there's not much room there. There's no leeway there for us to consider starting that separation now. You'll say, I'm not quite sure how helpful that is, but it was a very good reason why, and I'll see if I can find it.
Thank you very much, Councillor Dunlop, for that contribution. I'm particularly moved in this matter because we recently had the promise of a grant of £10,000 withdrawn on the basis that the funders were not prepared to pay the money to BCP, but were enthusiastic of paying the money to the Russell Cotes Museum and Gallery. Now, you know, this, of course, is one of the drivers that we have presented as part of the case for independence, that separation is really very important as we approach major funding organisations. We're also alert to the fact that one of the pieces of feedback from the Arts Council with our unsuccessful application to be part of the portfolio grouping was that our governance was out of date. You know, so it seems to me that we got, these are matters which will be righted, as Councillor Dunlop has said, as we achieve independent charity status. But in the interim period, which could be as much as 2 years, we shouldn't need to labour under this difficulty. I know it's a matter that we cannot resolve at this meeting, but I do look to the management committee to see whether there is a degree of support for us to press on this matter. George, and then
I'll support.
So, thank you very much.
I think it would be helpful to find out what the reason was that Beverly was given. Perhaps we could pursue that as a matter of urgency. I mean, I can see that somehow money going into a separate account, suppose Sarah took some takings at Russell Cotes, it went into a separate account. If that wasn't owned by the council, in effect, it's still council money going into a separate account. So there must be some sort of really tight reason for this. But I think we should press very hard and try and find a way around it. Even if the technical reason for not doing it is a strong one, there must be a way we can work around it. So I think we should press.
Councillor Yangar.
Thank you, Chair. I think there's at least a couple of things here. One is you started with the mention of the auditor's comment. I think what I'd ask you to let us know is, was the auditor's comment, shall we say, a sort of a general caution that's put into any organisation which doesn't have its separate bank account? So it's not quite a call to action immediately, but it's just a comment for the record. So sort of which of those is it, do you think? I didn't get the feeling it was an immediate call to action. And as you say, we are on a sort of direction to resolve it. The one about the donation not being given is a shame. And if there are more potentially like that, then that would give us the urgency, wouldn't it? I'm with my colleague. I'm inclined to believe that there is, though, a good reason. We shouldn't overlook this. There will be a good reason, I reckon, why. I don't quite know the exact reason from Beverly, but I think there is. I've seen something similar before, which is the council can't, with public purse, has got to watch this one very, very carefully indeed. So I think there is a legitimate argument coming the other way as well. But I will support us investigating this very quickly. Thank you.
Fiona.
I definitely agree. I think it's very complicated at the moment, and particularly as we go towards our destination, we need to have clear ideas about for budgeting and everything. And it's very difficult at the moment with, everything sort of underneath the BCP general account. I think visitors get a bit confused as well when they're paying at Russell Cotes because everything says BCP.
Yes.
Although it's an independent charity, so.
I think we see problems at a relatively modest level. For example, there aren't direct debit arrangements which would allow friends and others to, continue their involvement with us on a customary basis nowadays, right through to major funding agencies alerting us to the problems which they have in paying the grant sum to a local authority rather than to the specific charity that they have nominated. Well, I think with that...
Simon, who's on the financial team, might be...
Simon, are you able to illuminate this matter at all?
Not inquired with one of my colleagues, and so the person who would deal with the bank account side of things is back tomorrow. So what I'll do is I'll work on that tomorrow and come back to Sarah with a response, a financial services response for you. So you have a very clear reason why, everything goes through BCP bank account. One of the things I would say regarding the transactions, they're all collated within a very discrete suite of accounts that are purely specific to the Russell Cotes Museum. And what we do on an annual basis is we make sure that the management accounts, which go into the council's accounts, and the accounts which are presented for the charities are the same. Generally, the transactions are the same, but because there's different accounting requirements and materiality regarding the accounts that are recorded for the council's accounts and for the Russell Cotes accounts, the materiality levels are different, and that's what maybe causes a bit of discrepancy with the accounts that are reported for the two entities. Regarding a separate bank account, that's not necessarily practical or possible in a minute, but regarding additional donations, if you had, for instance, a Friends of Russell Cotes organisation with an independent bank account, you could potentially collect grants through that route, because that would be independent from the council. And we have that with other areas in the council as well, libraries, Upton House, Highcliffe. So, that and Poole Museum have an independent external arm with their own they have their own set of accounts, fully audited, but they can collect donations on behalf of, say, Poole Museum. But it doesn't come into the council's accounts unless it's invoice. So there are different routes for which you could undertake to access that additional funding.
Thank you very much for that. And, perhaps if you are able to inquire a little further into the matter and then report back, I should be very grateful, as I think this management committee will. Thank you.
I'll do that.
Can I rewind? There is just one thing. Paragraph 40 of the minutes of the last meeting on page 6 recommends that the building is revalued on commercial purposes, which is an issue that I have been alive to for a number of years, and I'm interested to know how that is and how and when that will happen.
Thank you very much. It's a very good question. I'm going to just refer to you, Sarah, in this matter, but I think we may have hit a bit of a buffer on this.
I've been trying to sort this out and work out what's going on, who's doing what. But it's a sort of one of those interminable circles where you, everyone refers back to the other person. So there was a proposal to do a full proper valuation, and it's just got, it gets lost between estates and insurance and Russell Cotes and so on. So it's one of those kind of internal things. But I think that for externalisation, we will need to have a full and evaluation done at an appropriate level. So it's in hand as it always is, but it's just this. The only thing I would say is that the Russell Cotes factor, we're about to be restructured. The council's been restructured, and Russell Cotes is going in with estates. So actually, it might be conversations with estates might be the reason.
I mean, that was my thought, Mr. Chairman, that the estates strikes me as the natural place.
Yes.
Subject to what the members have to say, but it looks to me like this is a real estate function. It's a real estate. It's a real estate valuation. Thank you.
I think. This is a very, and it has coursed through our discussions for some time. On the very helpful trajectory towards independence, which is in your report, Sarah, it would be quite useful if there was an insertion that says the revaluation of the estate. I mean, then it is actually established, because we're going to have to do it anyway. So let it be in the trajectory of activities towards independence. Alan.
I'm sorry to go back to the earlier point, but having read these minutes again, I note that the auditor said it needed extra work to complete the audit. So I think in making the case for breaking away and having a separate bank account, the extra cost should be brought into account as well.
Yes.
Because there's clearly is, that's the point. And they say it's exceptional to have it done that way.
Yes.
So it is unusual. The other point, of course, is reference to VAT. And I wonder if that is actually one of the key sticking points.
I think it is.
The separate VAT system.
Is it not a key sticking point in many?
Everything.
Yes. I think that my suspicion is the same as your own. I imagine that's why. We shall learn more in due course. With your permission, I will move us on to the public issues. There have been, to my knowledge, no submission of public questions or inquiries. Thank you very much. That allows us to move to item 5, an entertaining item of such detail that I know you are all poised to object to the disposal of the Huddersfield tramway plate, which receives, I think, a page and a half enough from me. Sarah, would you very, very briefly take us through these matters?
Indeed. Okay. Just to point out just two items that we've acquired over the last 6 months, fairly minimally. One more interesting, I think, is just look at the loans that we have been working on. It's really good to see, particularly the international loans are really back happening again. So we've just worked with Milan. That was interesting. They had 305,000 visitors to their exhibition, which is
fair to say not entirely to view this particular painting.
Presumably not. Although it is a quite interesting one. So various month sculptures we've lent for the first time, which is really interesting, to the Henry Moore Institute. It's good to have those there back. And we've got, so those ones are completed, some at the moment. So Venus Verticordia is at the moment in Munich, and we have another painting in Hamburg, and then others in Udine in northern Italy. So it's really good to see these things going on. I know I've just agreed another loan agreement with Forlì, which is in central Italy, for quite a large number of paintings to go out this time next year for a exhibition on pre-raphaelites in Italy, which will be really interesting. So that's always good to see that those going on. And actually, we're loaning to the British Museum one of our Burmese shrine that we have on display normally. So that's good. We always just repeat, try and balance it so that we
never lend too many of our iconic works. And we know that it brings visitors in. I know, you know, I've seen, met people who've come from Tokyo because they've seen, that, seen our things at, in Tokyo, but equally people turn up expecting to see something and then it's not there, so that's always a problem. Disposals, yes.
Can I just, I mean, I think this is a very good statement of the internationalism of this museum, often overlooked, but I mean, the places that works are going are in the Premier League. This is not a little bit of passing to the odd gallery in, you know, rural Dorset. This is serious, you know, serious loans. But my question with regard to the Kunsthalle in Munich, there is an exhibition of Pre-Raphaelite work that's coming to the Tate, is there not? Because I would have thought this is a major work of Rossetti, that there may have been competition for it.
There was, but the, we had made a commitment to Munich. So
who were the other bidders, just for a matter of interest?
So the Tate, I think the Tate did approach us, but we had already made that commitment to, that's, you know, that we... We don't tend to have very long deadlines, but many organisations, the Tate and so on, will require, you know, year, 2 years in advance. You're balancing off these, especially these the things like the Midsummer and Venus, which are often, you know, often in high demand. So, yes.
Well, this could be a very controversial point. It has gone to Germany and not to Britain.
Lots of just more general.
Yes, thank you. Well, press on.
Yes.
Now,
your treats for the day are it's amazing. And these we hold these up as you know, shame for curators, the things that we collect, which seemed like a good idea at the time, presumably, but obviously now in hindsight it's unlikely that we would be displaying a travel agent's model of Concorde in the Russell Cotes anytime soon. So yes, or plates about
why did we get it in the first place?
There was a transport museum in Bournemouth, wasn't there? So the Rothsay, is it the Rothsay Museum? You're going back 30, 40 years, there was a transport museum in Bournemouth, and some of the collections from them have entered the Russell Cotes, obviously. There's a typewriter museum. I think we've got rid of most of the typewriters, I hope. But some of these things have sort of lingered. So this is an opportunity to get rid of these things and hopefully, if possible, pass them on to a other suitable public museum. So they stay in the public domain, but if not, they will go to auction.
Councillor Iyengar.
Sorry, please, just if there's any mocking at all going on here. As I was at British Airways for 10 years. These things will have a cult following. Let's be in no doubt about this whatsoever. It may not be us as the cult following. And I must say, if we have any 747 models stashed away in the cupboards there as well, they will also have a cult following as well, since the aircraft is no longer flying, or not with BA, it's not. Thank you.
Very good. It's very interesting. Where are these things stored? Now are they gathering dust? And how many more are there of this type of thing?
So we have a study centre where we... So some of the things are on site, some of the things are off-site. And we have, as you'll see, as an appendix to this, which we haven't sent around, is the collection strategy. So the Russell Cotes, like all museums, has a strategy for what it's actually collecting and what it's trying to dispose of. So we have what we think is we call our core offer, which is the Russell Cotes Victorian offer about the arts and culture associated in the world travel. So that's the core offer is the Russell Cotes story. And then we will accumulate more material too that fits into that offer, but where things are superfluous, which will never be displayed, are, as you say, you know, costing money in terms of storage space, but also then, you know, have implications to the best storage of other objects, and it's best to get rid of them. But we operate within the Museum of Ethics, Museum Association Code of Ethics, which is why there is this very long document, which I appreciate seems ridiculous for a plate of the Huddersfield tram service. But if you know, if it was something more serious that you really want to consider all aspects of it. You know, we're dealing with the low-lying fruit here, trying to get rid of things which are, you know, no-brainers that we know that, you know, should go, like wheelbarrows and so on. But when it gets to more, you know, slightly more complex things, then you want to see the detail as to why we're getting rid of it, to ensure that we're not doing anything and we're not getting rid of something, you know, that is just not fashionable now, but in 10 years' time, people will say, goodness knows why. I mean, let's face it, the things like Venus Verticorta came to us because in the 60s, no one was interested in pre-Raphaelite art. That was us. So we don't want to. So maybe one day Ken Concord might be the thing. But
yes, yeah. So that's very much it'll be the Halifax plate somehow. But anyway, Beverly.
Thank you. I have to confess, I've not read the Museum Code of Ethics, I'm afraid. But does that prevent us from auctioning pieces? I'm just thinking in terms of these. Now, Councillor Angus mentioned these planes. I have to say I'd love the Concorde. However, there's no sort of auction value in some of these because these are quite unique little things.
No, there is. The Code of Ethics gives you a sort of hierarchy of how you respond to them. So the initial thing is to try and keep them in the public domain. So we offer them, first of all, to other museums. And we will have approached any museum that we know is particularly interested in, you know, trams of Hull or whatever, and then you go down, and if you know, essentially, it's if no public museum is interested in acquiring them, they will go to auction, and we have done that in the past with some of the other things that we've got disposed of, and if they no one wants to buy them at auction, then they will actually be destroyed, and the money that is made from going to auction, and it's about £30,000 that we have at the moment from the things that we've got rid of in the last few years, that is ring fenced only to be spent on new acquisitions or on the conservation of existing acquisitions. Yeah. It's not to be used for anything else. So that's ring fenced at the moment, and we will use that.
Okay. Good. Well, we need to formally approve the disposals that are proposed here. Do I see assent? And please pass on my congratulations. Sorry, but Councillor Dunn. Oh, that was approval. So, yeah, thank you. Pass on our commendation to Duncan, because I think some of his prose is worthy of Alan Bennett. His description of, you know, the rigging on some of the, I think it's wonderful. And it is just a level of detail that a curator will apply to objects. It's part of the business of galleries and museums. So, good. Item 6, which is the report of the museum and gallery over the last period, that is from the 1st of October to the 28th of February. Sarah.
Well, obviously you've got the report. I won't go through it in any great detail. Just really, I think the takeouts for us are that we've continued with sustained good performance. I think we've got a good offer at the moment. It's a good vibe, as we say, in the museum. All the activities that we're doing seem to be doing well. I mean, we were concerned, you know, I suppose like everybody about, you know, cost of living crisis and so on, whether that would impact on visitors, but doesn't seem to so far at all. Noticeably. So visitor numbers are back up to, I mean, I haven't got them for the end of the year, but we'll, I think, be pretty well back up to pre-COVID levels. And income's doing well as well. And we're just trying, I think, just to make sure it's sustainable. I mean, the problem for us is just always staffing is quite minimal. And we closed in January to polish the floors, as we always do for 2 weeks. And 5 out of 14 staff were off sick with various things from appendicitis to COVID to everything. And then, you know, you really notice it with a very small team dealing with it. So that's just the issue that we have. So just trying to make sure everything is kind of sustainable and within capacity. We just have lost one member of staff, unfortunately, who's had to leave because of poor health. We're just trying to recruit to that. So that's just a bit of a, well, just leaving us with a bit of extra work to do in terms of our outreach, our engagement activities, but we're recruiting at the moment. And in that, on that kind of note, I am just thinking about applying to the Arts Council. As I say in the report, and the Chair said, we didn't get our NPO funding from the Arts Council. So we are in a position to still apply to the Arts Council for further funding.
However, this would be really around audience development work and so on, and you know, it's all additional work rather than supporting core activity. So I'm just kind of mulling at the moment as to whether whether it's just too much pressure on top of what we're already trying to achieve to do that, or whether it will be worth pursuing. So that's where we are at the moment, just to kind of continue this really good set of work that we're doing. I would just say that we had a sixpence day last Friday, and we had 695 visitors. So it was absolutely, it was very busy, which is great. And we also did a late last week, which was on about women and art, and that was really very popular as well, with lots of contemporary artists in the galleries and things. So those kind of things are really doing well. So it's a good place at the moment, I would suggest.
Well, Sarah, thank you. Thank you very much indeed for that. Are there any questions colleagues would like to put to Sarah? Fiona.
Could I just add a comment? We started doing the late nights last year for centenary year, but what I have noticed, because I do get involved with them, is that it's really expanding the age group of visitors. We're getting a lot more younger people coming to visit and getting very enthusiastic about Russell Cotes, which is, I think, very encouraging. And I would like to add that I think the achievements, when you look at Sarah's report, quite amazing when you think how small the staff team is. We volunteers dip in and out, but it's a very small team, and it's quite incredible what's been achieved.
Thank you very much, Fiona. And I think that's something I would personally endorse, and I'm sure it has the sympathy of the management committee as a whole. Alan.
Item 29, Sarah, are you able to give us any informal feedback on the results of these focus groups?
I should have mentioned that. That's a really great step forward, that the focus groups. No, to be honest, we've had the first meeting, which was literally just saying hello and inviting them to look around the museum. But I think they will be really valuable. So we're doing four focus groups. Visitor experience, programming, so we're bringing in various curators and educationists and so on to look at our programming. Access, looking particularly at physical access, and equality and inclusion, looking at representation and decolonisation. And they've all been held, the first initial meetings have all been held, very successful, but just very, very low-key, just to introduce them. We've given all the members free tickets, and so they can come in and go as they want. And then we've identified the first meetings, which are going to happen within the next few weeks, I think, April, I think, where we've got specific subjects or focus that we're going to drill down into with those kind of groups. So I think they will be a really good opportunity to address kind of any specific, very specific issues, but nothing has come as yet, but specifically.
Thank you very much. You do note, I don't want to get a reputation for curiosity, but how did Queen Victoria lose her nose?
I don't know. I lost in the midst of time. I have to say, we thought we'd start a little fundraising campaign to see how that might go, just see what, take the temperature, as it were. And so far, it's not really taken off very well. So we might have to do a bit more work on that one. I think maybe instead of Queen Victoria's nose, best doesn't hit the mark.
No, I think probably restoration of the work by John Gibson might be more attractive. Okay. May I seek your approval that we accept and note the report? Councillor Ingyar.
Yeah. Just before we do, just coming back, Sarah, you mentioned something in the middle of that about sort of how to keep on top of all what's going on and then all the additional things as well. And I think that is it's an interesting point. It's quite a recurrent thing. And more's the point with the focus groups, more things will potentially come out of that as well. And you, as always, I guess, you've got the situation of keeping the show running as well as a whole load of things in orbit as well and deciding those. It does strike me, if I may, almost unfair to just leave you alone to just get on with it. And I think that there may be something here about how, as the management committee here, first of all, the sort of the scene is set with the broad strategic journey, but also just maybe one level down from that with all the, dare I say, more tactical things that, Sarah, you're having to think about and decide how to run your next quarter or your next 6 months. Maybe there's more help that the management committee can help Sarah with. I genuinely mean help, in that, whether it's the whole committee or whether it's a subcommittee or something. Let me just offer that, Chairman, just for your own reflection, not to, you know, not necessarily to respond now, but where we can help Sarah together in thinking about all of these things and how then, you know, which is more important, which is less important, and so on.
I think that's a very, very good proposal. What we will be doing very shortly is seeking a project officer who will take on quite a bit of the load that will be necessary to take us through to the transition period. But nonetheless, I think there are other areas where our collective advice and support could be rendered. Thank you. Can we now move with the approval and receipt of the management report to the next item, which is concerning the repair and renewal project, which has been funded by the Arts Council England and by BCP. Sarah, it's a very comprehensive report here, but are there any things that you particularly like to draw our attention to?
No, I suppose it's literally happening as we speak. So today they've started just tearing up the plant rooms at the museum. So I think for the next, just to be aware really, that for the next year, on and off, there will be major works going on in the plant room. So all the plant rooms are being stripped, and all the equipment, heating equipment, will be replaced. So it's being done in phases so that we can maintain the environmental conditions of the building, and at the right time to ensure the minimum amount of impact, as it were. But the museum will be quite noisy, quite dusty and dirty, possibly. We don't know. I suspect there are going to be periods when it's going to be pretty horrible, and then it's going to be periods when it's relatively okay. So the first bit of phase of work has literally just started. The site was prepared last week, and the work is starting today. And I mean, there is, again, you know, saying about the impact, so we have to do builders' hours for them. So again, it's just kind of the buildings being opened for extended periods in order to accommodate the engineers. So the three main plant rooms that deal with the main house and galleries are being done. That's all in hand and scheduled. And the conservatory is going out, the building work for the conservatory is going out for tender, hopefully, as we speak. Hopefully do that in the summer. And then the final air handling unit, which manages the plant room that manages the cafe block, the modern wing, is slightly up in the air. That's the least important, because we don't need to have sort of museum standard controls in there. So we've got a little bit of a leeway there, because obviously the challenge is that obviously costs, building costs and things are going up very considerably more than inflation. And we're, you know, concerned that we will have enough to, we have got good contingency, but obviously just always aware that things might cost might escalate. But that's what's going on. And the only thing that will happen is that when we do the air handling plant room, the final plant room is actually above the ceiling in the cafe. So there's no way that they can safely manhandle the very large bits of equipment up there while people are eating in the cafe below. So effectively, we're going to have to close the museum for that period, because the only access is through the cafe. So that is just up in the air at the moment. We're just going to think, obviously, what we'll try and do is minimise the amount of time we're closed for, but obviously, public safety comes first, so we'll have to see. So it potentially might be closed for a month in January next year for that.
Of which we usually close for two weeks
anyway. Yeah, so it's slightly extended, so we'll see what happens there. But other than that, we're behind schedule, but we're now back on track, so we should be able to deliver.
Good. Are there any questions with regard to this report? Alan?
Just a very quick one. I note that you've got to reinstall gas boilers. Does that possibly mean that in 10 years' time they'll all have to be replaced again? Is there no other solution?
There is no other solution, because in order to use... we have not got the power supply, the electrical power supply, to supply electrical equipment. It would cost hundreds of thousands to install that, and the cost of running it would still be too great. So we're just not there yet. But I suppose that, yes, so I suppose that potentially in, you know, in if gas boilers are phased out in whenever, then we'll have to look, well, they'll phase out the fitting of them, whether they'll phase out the usage of them. But yes, I suppose this should last 20 years, but that's, yeah, that's why we'd looked into it, but it just was not feasible or economic to do it.
Thank you. I speak from sort of experience, and I think, George, you probably endorse this, that M&E, mechanical and electrical, is often the most expensive part of building, and of course it's invisible. So for the public, with all this money being invested, well, you can't see it, but it's absolutely critical to the functioning of the building. And I'm very alert to the fact that the M&E has been woefully under-invested in over the last years. So this is really very, very critical work that's being done.
Can I just also come back? When I was talking to the engineers this morning, just before I came out, we were discussing it, and they were saying that we will, because of the efficient, the equipment will be significantly more efficient, particularly next summer, this summer actually, we should see the benefits because the cooling will be significantly cheaper. And interestingly, with the, you know, obviously hugely increased bills that we're paying at the moment, the most expensive time for running the building was the last summer of cooling everything down, not so much the heating. So that will be, so we should see the benefits really quite within months to come. So that's a hopeful sign.
Thank you very much. And I take it that we both note and accept the report that Sarah has provided. And that allows us to move to item 8, which is an update and progress towards externalisation. And agenda item 8 does sort of summarise what we have done. And, you know, I don't think we should underestimate the efforts of all members of the management committee in achieving very important approval by the full BCP Council that this endeavour was both appropriate and should be expedited. What we are now faced with is the implementation of that that resolve. And one of the important recommendations is the establishment of a project steering group to oversee and support progress, which may in part assist a little in meeting the point that you made earlier, Mohan. But before we get to that, perhaps you'd like to give a short summary from your point of view, Sarah, in the matter of externalisation.
Thank you. Yes. And as you know, after the previous meeting in October, we did actually get the paper recommending externalisation through Cabinet and through Council on the 10th of January, indelibly printed on my brain forever, I think. So that's an amazing achievement, and yes, for everyone, and just such a huge amount of work. So we got that through. That was the first step. Then the next stage was to get Heritage Lottery Fund, National Heritage Lottery Fund support for the quite considerable costs. And that approval came through just a few weeks ago. So that's, they've agreed to provide £98,500 to support the governance work. And then there's £20,000 of match funding, which will come from core funding. To do that, and that's obviously quite a lot of work to be done which will be interesting. So the two interesting developments since as I was writing this, I actually got a letter or an email from the Charity Commission, who I'd asked some time ago about timescales. And they have emailed me back to, because I'd offered them what do they see the timescales were for the implementation of externalisation. And they have sent me a very slightly complicated email, which I don't quite understand all the processes involved, but
suggesting that there will not be any parliamentary time to do this until this time next year, until 2024. So we're looking, I was suggesting to them a timescale for achieving externalisation of 1st of April 2024 to the 1st of April 2025, and they were suggesting that the latter part of that time frame would be more achievable. So that gives us, so and I, as I, as you see, I wrote out a list of a kind of a timeline, really, of all the different things that we will need to do to achieve this, and obviously had no real kind of understanding yet from that at that stage of what the timeframes were from the DCMS and parliamentary schedules, but now we have a little bit of more, of an understanding of that. But I think I still need to go back to Charity Commission to fully understand it. So I think the major step from my point of view, I think, is working with our solicitors to understand what changes we need to the trusteeship and to the arrangements so that the council as trustee can apply formally to the Charity Commission for the change of trustee, and that is the first thing that we need to do. And we have had some quotes from lawyers for the costs of that, so that's now sort of a matter probably of procurement, of trying to set that going, because it's quite a significant amount of money, so it will have to go through the full council procurement systems.
I believe in that regard that Bates Wells, who have advised us before, may be one of the firms that we would favour.
Yeah, that we would certainly approach. So yes, Bates Wells have been in touch, and they, yes, because they obviously worked on us over this for years on this, so they have all that background information. They've been quite supportive. The legal team here at the council have been very helpful in then nominating someone to work with me on moving that forward. But I think we will need some serious, significant legal advice on what exactly we're asking for the parliamentary scheme to achieve. So this is essentially why we think that it'd be a good idea to set up a steering group. There are so many moving parts to this, and so we just need that steering group to meet together and manage that kind of whole process, and so that everybody's, everyone has input and everyone's voice is heard, and we can just move things forward. Because I think the issues that we've had around trying to tie in all these different kind of schedules so everything moves forward at the same time, and you know, everyone's got different pressures, obviously, and completely understandable. So I'm hoping, I think we've got pretty good response back from this group of people, and I think it's really helpful that the someone from the project management team, within the council, which understands how these kind of processes and what the governance arrangements are within the council, will also be on that committee to advise us, so that we can make sure that we fit within the council governance rules, which obviously quite complex and difficult for someone like me to understand. So I think that, if you're happy with this, gives a sort of framework of what needs to be done. I now have got some clarity from the Charity Commission, so I can probably rework this to understand better that it will be a slightly extended time frame, which is not surprising, but that we start this process, really, and we just have to move it forward and just tie in all these different elements.
And I believe that there is a proposal that the steering group's first meeting will be on the 4th of April. Is that correct? Well, first.
It's the Monday, isn't it? The 3rd of April. The 3rd of April, I think I've sent round. We have got the first meeting in the diary for that.
Yeah, and I do apologise that I'll be unable to attend that meeting, because I won't be in the country at that time. But nonetheless, I think it's quite important, because there are a number of people that are identified who are probably less well-informed of progress so far and the requirements. So I think that meeting should go ahead on the 3rd as proposed. Are there any questions people would like to raise? Alan?
First of all, a bête noire. Is there not another word we can use apart from externalisation? If we have to use it, can we always spell it with an S, please?
Yes, it's
I think independence, maybe. Is full independence, maybe, well, better?
Freedom or something, but anyway.
Yeah.
The other serious point I was going to make, and I mentioned this to the chairman earlier, I saw Conor Burns on Friday at a social event, and he is now a backbencher. I mentioned what had happened in January, and he was delighted, and once again offered his support, which might be sort of more helpful now he's a backbencher. I don't know, he's got less other things on his mind. But of course, he was going to talk to Lord Parkinson in particular, as you may recall. So bear that in mind as we go forward.
Yeah. Mohan?
Yeah, Alan, you beat me to it in the, maybe we have it at the risk we're having the first meeting now, the project work, but in spring update, major stakeholders, absolutely the MPs and plural. So obviously it's Connor's constituency, but in fact, to the left and to the right as well. And, you know, we'll help. You can expect the councillors will help with that as well.
Thank you.
Okay. On the name, since it came up, I'd urge some care about the name on this one, because at the risk of maybe challenging what's already been said, one which is obviously kind of says what it means, but equally I caution a bit against about things like sort of freedom and so on. It's anything which is sort of like looks back with scorn about the Russell Cotes history. Don't go there. No. I'd suggest with this, we need to keep everybody together on this one, and we will, I'm sure. Thank you.
Yeah, externalisation with an S may suffice for the time being.
As a particular meaning in psychology, it's something we do that.
Yes. I'm currently doing some work for another country, but the Americanization of English is a source of ongoing problems. I'm correcting, and then they... enough. We are very grateful for that update, Sarah, which is a sort of summary, really, of where we are and where we are going. I do have a question.
Simon,
please.
Yeah. Without being a party pooper, we need to be mindful of the costs involved, both the transitional costs, the ongoing impact for both the council and the external organisation. We need to make sure that it's robust and viable so that, the facility can grow and thrive. Really, we need to make sure that there is financial sustainability. What I don't know, because, we read in the press and all that as well about the pressures with the council, how much money will be put into this project for transition, and that's maybe something we need to be mindful of as well. Is we might say, well, actually, this is what we want and need, but this is what the council can afford, and will that create a funding gap, or will it create a funding surplus? And I think one of the things I was watching The Apprentice the other night, and when they present their proposals, they have a very deep dive by advisors, so to speak, just to make sure that what's being proposed is a very, very valid proposition. And I think we need to be mindful with the cost of living crisis at the minute, increase in pay awards, etc., etc. Other providers are having their other external providers are having their grants capped or cut, and we need to make sure how that this all fits into the same process, so that when the organization does externalize, it's in its best shape to flourish and thrive. One of the things I would say, comparing, and this is really a real positive about the Russell Cotes, is when you look at some of our other facilities, they don't earn the same amount of money from the public as the Russell Cotes. Most of Sarah's income is all earned from the public, not the same level of grant income. Or, for instance, other providers have got a really strong wedding focus. Sarah's income is very mixed and comes from a variety of bases. So I think we need to be mindful. Whilst that's really good, it also puts at risk, if there's a downturn. So what we're very conscious with the financials is that when it goes, it stacks up, and it's ready to meet the challenges it will have ahead of it.
Thank you very much, Simon. The report, as do we have Fiona, so I do apologise. Go ahead.
Sorry, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to pick up Mr. Frost's comment about externalisation, particularly when it comes to involving stakeholders. My background is charities on a national level as well. And a common term used was independent charitable status, which people then understand because it enfolds all. Whereas externalisation is hard to get round if you're not familiar with charities. So I'm just suggesting that that could be used as an alternative.
Yes, and of course that is precisely what the charity commissioners will be transacting. So it is a statement of fact. I think perhaps the introduction of statement of fact, you know, can be sensitively applied in the sort of in the months ahead. I take your point. Are there any other matters with regard to item 8?
Only one other thing. People are mindful of events in May this year. And potentially events in May next year. You know all of this. So faces may change, but actually I think it absolutely makes perfect sense to go ahead with a meeting on the 3rd of it with the people who currently exist. Let's get going with this, no reason to not. And let's live with the fact that the faces may change, but actually the direction is being firmed up even more and more as we go along. So absolutely, you know, godspeed.
Thank you very much for that. If that concludes item 8, it does, in fact, conclude the meeting today. But are there any other matters that people... we don't have any other business on our agenda. It is customary that the chairman is notified if it is a major item, but I'm quite happy to take any points that people might wish to make at this stage. There being none... yours, Councillor Dunmore.
There's always one from me. Actually, I don't have any other business. I just want to say, as this is on Thursday, we go into pre-election time. But however, this is our last meeting. I just wanted to say how much I've enjoyed being a portfolio holder and being part of Russell Cotes, but more importantly, to really thank everyone. Thank everyone for what they do. Thank the people who give up their time to come onto this board. And thank you to Sarah, who I think has done a pretty amazing job, actually, in bringing us to where we are. So it was just to say thank you to everybody. That was all.
Councillor Dunlop, thank you very much for that. And I'm sure others of us here endorse the points you've made with regard to Sarah and the work that she's undertaken on our behalf. With that said, I declare the meeting closed.